Welcome back to Altium Academy. I'm your host, Zach Peterson. Today, we are going to be looking at a longer design review for one of our recent 1 minute design review submissions. And this is a design for a 3 GHz RF amplifier. Now, this project had several issues in it, and I think this is a great learning experience for all of the new designers out there, and especially anyone that's looking to get into RF design. So let's go ahead and hop into Altium and get started. Now we get a ton of 1 minute design review submissions and I have a huge backlog. So if anybody has submitted a design for a 1 minute design review and hasn't seen it yet, I apologize. We just have way too many requests to get to them in the timeliest manner. But every so often I see a design review submission that deserves a deeper dive. And this one that we're gonna look at today is definitely one of those designs. This design was sent in by Sina Tajik and this design is for an RF amplifier operating at around 3 GHz. Here I have the design pulled up on screen. You can see here in the schematics that we have an RF input. This RF input goes to a low noise amplifier. We then have here a bandpass filter. We have another amplifier that brings up the filtered signal. And then it looks like this goes out to a UFL connector. We have a 0 ohm resistor option for connecting to it. And then there's this RF in net. And then you can see over here on this RF in net, it goes over to this component, which is an envelope detector operating from DC to 6 GHz. So I wasn't given any information about the intended frequency range for this design when the files were submitted to me on LinkedIn. But just from looking at the filter, you can see here from the filter description that the operating frequency range is from 3300 megahertz to 3900 megahertz. So basically 3.6 gigahertz. So we basically have an input signal comes in, it gets amplified, gets filtered, gets amplified again, and then we pass it over to this envelope detector. And the entire point of this envelope detector is basically to extract some part of the signal that is overlaid on top of that carrier signal at 3.6 gigahertz. Now in the schematics, there's a few things that I want to address. And the first thing that we're going to address is of course the overall structure of the schematics. In these schematics, this is done in a pretty typical way as you would see in a FLAC project that's not too large. You have everything in one sheet and that's perfectly acceptable. But one thing I want to bring up here is with a lot of these components, we have a really important thing that's missing from this design, which is part numbers. Now, in this design, since we're operating at 3.6 gigahertz, these part numbers actually do matter a lot. Here, if I click on this AC coupling capacitor, or this ferrite bead, or these capacitors, or any of these other passive components that you see around this design, none of them have any parameters or any part numbers attached to them. Now, this is really important. We need to know specific part numbers for a lot of these components. And that's because we need to make sure that whatever part is selected is capable of performing its intended function within the desired frequency range. Most important among these parts is these AC coupling capacitors that you see here along the RF signal path. So whenever you go to a part search engine, of course, like Octopart, make sure that you look through the data sheet and you actually check what is the self-resonant frequency of that capacitor that you're considering using. Now, just as an example, I'm over here on Johansson Technology's website. And if I just scroll through here for all of the data for their low ESR multi-layer capacitors, you can see here that they have a lot of data, but they do have one graph which shows the resonant frequency for these 0402 capacitors as a function of the capacitance value. And so you can see here that in general, you do get a higher self-resonant frequency as you decrease the capacitance, as of course we would expect for a capacitor. Now here, for example, even in this design, if you were to use a 22 picofarad capacitor as specified in the schematics, at 22 picofarads, you would basically have a self-resonant frequency right at about 2 gigahertz. So that's very bad if you're trying to operate at 3.6 gigahertz because we want to ensure the path along that RF feed line has the lowest possible impedance, and that means we want to make sure that this self-resonant frequency is above our operating frequency, not below it like we see here. So make sure to look for a graph just like this whenever you're looking for an RF specified capacitor, particularly for an AC coupling application. The next thing that I want to look at concerns what's happening here on this RF feed line and some of the components that we have here. And in particular, we are using two low noise amplifiers in series along with this bandpass filter. And then we're feeding that over to this envelope detector circuit. Now, I want to bring up the series use of amplifiers first, because the series use of amplifiers is very important, especially if you're dealing with RF power. Now, in this example or in this design, I actually don't know what the input power is, so I really can't evaluate whether this is going to be a problem, but I'm bringing this up more as a learning point for most of the viewers out there who may be new to RF design. Now, in this design, I'm pretty sure that we're dealing with an AM signal because here we're using an envelope detector circuit, and one of the entire points of using an envelope detector circuit is to pull off the low frequency modulation that's applied to the amplitude of our 3.6 gigahertz carrier signal. But I think it's worth asking the question, could we use this series arrangement of power amplifiers with an FM signal? Well, the answer is that you have to be very careful with that, because when you have a frequency modulated signal, whenever you feed that signal into this RF power amplifier, you can generate what are called intermodulation products. And basically, these are beat frequencies between the two signals that produce your FM modulation. So when you put those into an amplifier, if that amplifier is operating very close to its saturation point, that amplifier will create these intermodulation products. Those can then get put into another amplifier, and those intermodulation products can get amplified, and then they can also produce intermodulation products. So you can produce these groups of intermodulation products due to the beat frequencies that are created between all of these different sidebands you generated from the original FM signal. Now, I bring all this up to point out that it's unclear whether or not this filter would be able to remove the intermodulation products before feeding the signal into the second amplifier. So I think it's very important to also note that it's generally not recommended to use series power amplifiers in this way due to the fact that you can generate these intermodulation products, and you should calculate what the amplitude of those intermodulation products will be if you do plan to use these series cascaded arrangements of power amplifiers. I think it's much better to just get a single power amplifier that has higher gain rather than to try and cascade multiple amplifiers in series like you see here. And finally, one thing you could do is you could also just put this filter circuit on the output of the second amplifier, basically accepting that you might generate some intermodulation products, but then you're using the filter to try and remove those at certain frequencies within the stop bands. Next thing I'd like to do is to jump into the PCB. Now, here I have the PCB pulled up on screen, and if we zoom in and look along the RF path, we can see quite a few things that we need to address in this design. So the first thing is all of these stitching vias that you see along this RF signal. Now, the RF signal itself is also quite large, and if you just kind of zoom in here along to this very first amplifier, you can see here that this signal, or this trace, is so wide that it creates a very small clearance to the neighboring pads as it comes into the input. So this is bad. This is something that would get marked as no bid by most manufacturers, because the clearance here, as I've already measured it in the past, is basically 2 mils. Now, if we just zoom out a little bit, let's look at what's going on with these stitching vias. Well, here you can see that some of these stitching vias just don't have any net assigned to them at all. As you can see, I'm clicking on them and then they have no net listed here in the properties panel. Some of them are assigned to a net, but they're assigned to basically this pad on this coupling capacitor. So what we should do with these stitching vias is we should assign them to the ground net. And here with this surrounding ground polygon, you do have it set to pour over all same net objects, but it doesn't pour over any of these stitching vias because, of course, these are not assigned to the ground net. And so just as an example with these three vias, if I just assign those to the ground net, do a quick polygon pour, you can see that the polygon pour does extend over and attempt to cover these vias, of course, within the limit specified by the clearance rule in the PCB rules and constraints editor. Now that's the first thing that should be changed along this RF feed line, because of course without that, these stitching vias are all going to be floating. Next thing I'd like to bring up is the size of these vias. Here, if I just click on one of these vias and we scroll down, we can see what the size of these vias is. The pad diameter is 0.4 millimeters and the hole size is 0.2 millimeters, or we have basically a 16 mil diameter pad and an 8 mil diameter hole. Now, why do I bring this up? Is that good or is that bad? Well, one of the reasons I bring that up is because here you can see we don't have a lot of stuff on this board. This isn't a high density board, so we don't really need to push the via size down to 8 mil drill diameters. You can use a larger via drill diameter in this design, and you're not really going to see any impact on the electrical performance or on the RF performance. What it is going to do is reduce the cost. If you need to use smaller diameter vias, that's fine, but you should do it in applications where you actually need it, typically in applications where you have higher density. But here with a lower density design, you don't need to have 8 mil drills. It's just going to add cost where you don't need it. I would suggest increasing the diameter of those drills to 12 mils. That's going to cut out a lot of the fabrication cost. Then if you increase the size of those drills, just of course make sure to increase the size of the pad if that pad is not going to be sitting inside of a copper pour. Next, let's take a look at the layer stack manager. Here inside the layer stack manager, we've specified a 12 mil sheet of Rogers 4003C. Now, do you really need this for 3.6 gigahertz? Well, the answer is usually no. At 3.6 gigahertz, you probably don't need this advanced of a laminate in the design in order for the design to work properly. I see a lot of discussion out there about RF design from people who frankly don't know a lot about RF design, but they always tell you that you have to use these low decay laminates in order for RF designs to allow signal propagation with low loss. The reality here is that most RF designs operating at this frequency actually just use standard FR4 unless they're operating at low signal to noise ratios. Now, without any kind of target power output or signal to noise ratio target in this design, I really can't tell you if this is the best choice or not, but a lot of times you really don't need a Rogers 4003C laminate operating at 3.6 gigahertz. Now, if you were operating at 36 gigahertz, you would definitely need a more advanced laminate like this Rogers 4000 series laminate or even a Rogers 3000 series laminate. But in this design, that's simply not the case. The other thing that's very important here is the impedance defined in the stack up. And if I go over to the impedance tab, you can see here that we do have an impedance defined, and that gives a trace width of about 26 mil for a 50 ohm impedance. But we have a problem here. This is not specified as a single coplanar waveguide. So what we should do here is define this as a single coplanar trace, and then we should set a clearance limit in this design in order to get an accurate trace width. This allows us to calculate the trace impedance assuming the presence of this coplanar ground. And I know we need to account for the presence of this coplanar ground because we have coplanar ground in this design, and I can tell that the intention is to have this coplanar ground run up close to this trace. We don't have it running up close to the trace because of the via issues that I mentioned before. Once that is fixed, that coplanar ground is going to run up close to this trace, and we would then have to recalculate the trace width that gives us that 50 ohm impedance. The next major thing I want to bring up in this PCB layout is the fact that this design is actually meant for use on four layers, not on a two-layer board. So you should be using a thin outer dielectric, or at minimum, you should be tapering down these traces so that you can get thinner traces to route into the pins on some of these components. So here I can see that you've basically used a 10 mil trace coming into the pads on this component. But what you should have done is you should have applied a taper, and you can do that using a very long teardrop. You can draw it in manually, or you can use the neck down rule in the PCB rules and constraints editor. But regardless, this trace should taper down to the width that you need from this larger width if you are going to do this on a two-layer board. But I would argue that this design was actually meant for a four-layer board. That would do two things. If you had this on a four-layer board with a thinner outer layer dielectric, such as, for example, a 5 mil outer layer dielectric, this is then going to allow you to immediately use a 10 mil trace width with a 10 mil clearance, and then you wouldn't have to worry about having this 26 mil wide trace here, and then taper it down using one of the methods I described earlier. The other reason I know that this was meant for use in four layers is because of this VPOS line as we have here. This VPOS line has to run between two different sides of this component, and then you would have the RF line routing in on top of it. Well, if you have this as a two-layer board, as you can see, this VPOS line cuts out the ground beneath this trace, and then that creates the possibility for high EMI susceptibility, radiated emissions due to reflection, both of which are bad. If we instead had a four-layer board with a ground plane below this surface layer, we would then have uniform ground below this RF trace coming into this envelope detector circuit, and that would ensure we eliminate any of that EMI susceptibility risk or any of those impedance mismatch risks coming into this envelope detector circuit, as you can see here. Now, there's just a few more things that I want to point out in this design. One of them is something that we see very often, and it's a very simple DFM check that you can perform in 3D inside Altium, and that is here we have some low clearance between the silkscreen edge and the solder mask opening. And if I just put this into 3D and zoom in, you can see very clearly that we have the solder mask overlapping the silkscreen edge, as well as overlapping some of the copper. Now, of course, a new designer is going to say, hey, JLC PCB removes that for me, and I don't have to worry about it. Well, if JLC PCB is willing to do that to your design, imagine what else they're willing to do to your design without telling you. And imagine what they're going to borrow from your design without telling you. This is actually a common problem that happens with some overseas fabs. They make changes to your design for their benefit, not for your benefit. Now, of course, this is a very simple check that you can do visually in 3D. As you can see here, I'm just zooming in and scanning over some of these components. It's very clear that we have silkscreen that is much too close to these pads. The other thing that you can do is, of course, just run a design rule check. If you have the design rules set up with a non-zero value for silkscreen to solder mask clearance, it will flag as an error when you do a design rule check. This is actually one of the most common DRC errors that we see in all of the 1 minute design review submissions. Finally, let's look at these mounting holes. Here in the 2D view, if I just go over to the corner, you can see here that we have a mounting hole, and it is assigned to the ground net. And that mounting hole pad on the top layer is bridging this guard ring around the exterior of the PCB and this interior polygon that is also assigned to the ground net. So it basically makes this outer ring going around the PCB totally ineffective. You just created a bridge between the guard ring that you're using to basically take the role of a chassis ground and the internal system ground. This has a very simple fix. Just move these mounting holes in closer to the interior of the PCB, or better yet, just set the pad size on these mounting holes to be the same as the hole size. So you have the hole size in the right location, and I can kind of tell just by looking in 3D where the edge of the polygon is for the system ground, and it goes around the edge of this hole. But the pad size is so large that it is basically bridging across this protective edge ground and the internal system ground. So make sure to remove that pad or make the pad extremely small, and then you won't have that problem. So I've talked about a lot of stuff in this deep dive review. We talked about some of the stuff in the schematics, we talked about stuff in the PCB layout, but I want to hear your opinion. Let me know your thoughts on this design in the comments section. And of course, I am going to post this video on LinkedIn. If you are seeing this on LinkedIn, let me know what you think of this design in the comments section on my posts. And of course, if you have a great design that you want to have reviewed in our 1 minute design review series, make sure to come find me on LinkedIn. You can send me a message with your design files or your manufacturing files. Thanks for watching this video, everybody. Make sure to hit the like button, hit the subscribe button, leave your comments and questions in the comments section. And last but not least, don't forget to call your fabricator, folks. We'll see you next time.